Oh, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Sego ani buju wacheya kwe kwe. As the mayor of the city of Kingston, I offer these words in the spirit of this gathering. Let us bring our good minds and hearts together as one to honor and celebrate these traditional lands as a gathering place of the original peoples and their ancestors who were entrusted to care for Mother Earth since time immemorial. It is with deep humility that we acknowledge and offer our gratitude for their contributions to this community, having respect for all as we share this space now and walk side by side into the future. We were just meeting as a committee of the whole closed meeting. We did discuss one item related to the coal gasification plant and brownfields update. So I will ask now for a motion that council rise from the committee of the whole closed meeting and that the rules of bylaw number 2010-1 be waived and the clerk report.
Moved by Councillor Allen, second by Councillor Osanek, that council rise from the committee of the whole closed meeting and that the rules of bylaw number 2010 be waived and the chair and the clerk report.
Please vote. And that carries. Next, I'll ask for an approval of the addeds. We have only a couple of communication items. Sorry, so we do have a recommendation then that we have to approve. Mr. Clerk?
Moved by Councillor Boehm, second by Councillor Candon, that Council authorize the Mayor and Clerk to execute an agreement of purchase and sale and any other required documents in a form satisfactory to the Director of Legal Services for the purchase of 6 Clarence Street in accordance with the directions and instruction provided to staff by Council when it was considered in report number 15-425 at its closed meeting session of November 3rd, 2015, and that the purchase of approximately $540,000 including legal fees and closing costs, be funded from the Municipal Capital Reserve Fund.
Please vote. Still one person to vote. And that carries. Okay, now we'll ask for the approval of the addeds, just noting the couple of communications items that we have there. Can I have a mover, please? Moved by Councillor George, seconded by Councillor Neal. Please vote. And that carries. Are there any disclosures of potential pecuniary interest? Councillor Stroud.
Thank you, Your Worship. I, Peter Stroud of the Council of the Corporation of City of Kingston, declare my pecuniary interest in the matter of Clause A, Report Number 17, because my spouse is a volunteer at this nursery school.
Okay, thank you. Is there anybody else? Councillor Hutchison.
Thank you, Your Worship. I, Rob Hutchison, the Council of the Corporation of the City of Kingston, declare my pecuniary interest in bylaw number 5206-38. As my employer, Kingston Cooperative Homes, is applying to change the names of those authorized to issue parking tickets on its property.
Okay, thank you very much. So seeing no other hands, we will move to presentations. We do have one presentation this evening. Doug Jeffries, member of the Kingston and District Sports Hall of Fame, will present the inductees for 2016. Mr. Jeffries.
Mayor Patterson, members of council and special guests, on behalf of President Corey Abrams and the Board of Directors, it is indeed my honor to present the list of 5 inductees who will formally become members of the Kingston and District Sports Hall of Fame at the 21st annual dinner to be held at Our Lady of Fatima Parish Hall on Friday, May the 6th. I would like to publicly acknowledge and thank the members of our selection committee for all their hard work resulting in the list of five. The names will be read alphabetically, and as they are unveiled, the inductee or their representative may stand while the bio is read. And to save time, please hold your applause until all are introduced. Barbara Allen, a builder in Gulf. Unfortunately, Barbara couldn't be here tonight because of the inclement weather. Born in Toronto, Barbara moved to the Kingston area in 1976 and quickly became a member of the local golfing community through the Garrison Club. Her passion for the game, her laser focus on tasks, and her willingness to share her knowledge are all phrases used to describe Barbara's commitment to her sport. A tireless volunteer, she has served as president and a board member of the Golf Association of Ontario. With Golf Canada, Barbara has been a governor, executive committee member, board of directors member, and the governor council chair. At the local level, she was very key in establishing the Golf for the Cure tournament, and that has been run for 10 years now. And she's also established the player development program for this district in the Ontario Ladies Golf Association. Barbara has also served as tournament chair at numerous Golf Canada championships, and in 2007 was the non-playing captain of the Canadian Women's National Amateur Team at the Five Nations Cup in South Africa. In 2014, Barbara Allen was recognized by Golf Canada with a Distinguished Service Award for her significant impact on the game in her community and across Canada. Barbara Allen. Mary Jane Besselink, an athlete in basketball. Born in Kingston, Mary Jane began her basketball career under the watchful eye of Kingston and District Sports Hall of Fame member Don Pete Peterson at St. Patrick's Public School on Patrick Street and in the Knights of Columbus Basketball League, before continuing on to Regiopolis Notre Dame, where she was a multi-sport athlete, playing basketball, volleyball, and soccer, rowing and participating in track and field as a high jumper and relay runner. All of this love of competition and commitment to her school sports program earned Mary Jane the Regiopolis Notre Dame Junior Athlete of the Year in grades 9 and 10 and Senior Athlete of the Year in grades 11, 12, and 13. Mary Jane played for Team Ontario twice, winning a gold and a silver medal, and being named the All-Star team for the tournament in 1988. And in 1989, Mary Jane earned a full scholarship to the University of Hartford, where she became a four-year starter for the Hawks. She led the team in rebounds each of her four seasons, led the team in scoring twice, and blocked shots once. More than 20 years after finishing her career at the university, Mary Jane is still listed in the top 10 for the school in points, scoring average, field goals, field goal attempts, rebounds, rebound average, block shots, games started, and average minutes per game. Described as a tremendous athlete, a humble person off the court, but a fiery competitive on it, she was a true trailblazer for other athletes following their dreams. Mary Jane has been recognized for her contributions to basketball with inductions into the St. Patrick's, Regiopolis Notre Dame, University of Hartford, and the New England Basketball Halls of Fame. Mary Jane Besselink. Betty Bush, an athlete in curling. Husband Tony is here, along with son Tom. Born in Trois-Rivières, Quebec, Betty Bush was a resident of Kingston from 1967 until her death in 2015. A member of the Royal Kingston Curling Club, Betty is described as a fine ambassador for not only her club, but for the city of Kingston in her travels throughout the province and country with her sport. Betty played in 17 provincial curling finals since 1991 and 2 Canadian Master Women's Championships. Betty's curling resume is extensive, and since 1980, 117 trophy wins are listed at the local, regional, provincial, and national levels. She is listed as a finalist or runner-up at various provincial-level curling championships in 28 of the last 30 years. Along with being such an active participant on the ice, Betty Bush was also an active volunteer in the Kingston curling community, helping to organize bonspiels and mentoring others within the sport. Betty was recognized by the province of Ontario with the Volunteer Service Awards in 2004 and in 2009 for her work with the Royal Kingston Curling Club. Sadly, Betty Bush passed away on October 28th, 2015, but we are left with the legacy of someone that was passionate about her sport throughout her life. Betty Bush. Joe Poutos, a builder, triathlon. And Joe will be represented tonight by his daughters, Nadia and Katrina. Born in Timmins, Ontario, Joe Poutos came to Kingston in 1980 and very quickly became involved in our local running community. Starting out as a volunteer with the Kingston Triathlon, Joe became the race director in 1988 and helped to make the Kingston Triathlon the best in Ontario and a race that athletes keep returning to every year. Joe was given recognition by the province of Ontario in 2013 for his 30 years of volunteer work with the triathlon. By the Kiwanis Club, he was a builder in 1990 and in 2013 with an Ontario Sports Award. Also in 2013, Joe Poutos was recognized with the SILAPS Volunteer Achievement Award. Joe is a great supporter of athletes in our community and has served as race director, chaired the race committee locally, and has served as the head referee for competitions as far away as Elliott Lake. One of his supporters wrote, "A builder needs to understand the event and to be aware of all aspects of it. Joe Poutos has lived that philosophy with commitment and passion." Joe Poutos. Corey Trudeau, an athlete in track and football. Parents Peter and Marilyn are here, along with spouse Louise. Born in Kingston in 1979, Corey Trudeau was a great and gifted athlete. He had a distinguished football and track and field career at Bay Ridge, and at one point, Corey held the Kingston area records for shot put and discus from midget throughout the senior levels. He won 8 medals at the Ontario High School Championships, 5 of them gold, and as a juvenile competitor with the Kingston Napanee Legion Track Club, won 3 national championship medals with gold in shot and discus and a bronze in the hammer throw. As a junior competitor, he won gold and silver in shot and placed 6th in the junior Pan Am Games shot put event. That success continued at Queen's University, where Corey became the most decorated individual athlete in Queen's history, with 5 consecutive trips to Canadian University Championships. Corey won 7 medals in his career at the OUA level and was the track and field MVP in 2001. And on the football field, Corey is described as an athlete with tremendous speed, agility, power, and strength. He garnered 2 second-team All-Star selections during his career at Queen's and was the Gaels team captain in 2002 and 2003 before playing briefly for the Toronto Argonauts of the Canadian Football League. Corey was runner-up as the Kiwanis Amateur Athlete of the Year in 1995, and he won the Royal Todd Memorial Trophy in 99, the Orrin Carson Memorial Trophy in 2000 and 2002. He won the Alfie Pierce Trophy as Queen's Rookie in 2000 and was also the Queen's Track and Field Rookie of the Year. Tragically, Corey Trudeau passed away on November 24th, 2014. He was inducted into the Queen's Football Hall of Fame in 2015. Corey Trudeau, a tremendous athlete in track and field. Thank you, guys. Mayor Patterson and members of council, there you have the newest members of the Kingston and District Sports Hall of Fame. This illustrious group now totals 163. Once again, thank you for this forum, for the first public unveiling of this latest group of individuals. We now ask that the inductees, their family members, and members of the board to stand, and we will exit Memorial Hall. Again, we thank you for your time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jeffries. So we do have one delegation on our agenda tonight. Victoria Robinson, Chair of the Allen Detweiler Relocation Committee, and Dana Del Brocco, Farrar Broadhead, and Lois Andrews will appear before Council and speak to Clause A, Report 17, received from the CAO consent with respect to community license with Allen Detweiler Nursery School at Rideau Crest Home. And again, just a reminder that all of our delegations have 5 minutes.
It's just going to be me. Good evening, Mayor Patterson and City Councilors. My name is Victoria Robinson, and I'm speaking to you tonight as a representative of Allen Detweiler Nursery School. All three of my children have attended Allen Detweiler, and I'm a member of the school's board. Allen Detweiler is a successful cooperative nursery school that has been in operation in Kingston for nearly 50 years. We offer a strong, child-centered, early childhood education program to young Kingston children. Children who leave our program go on to excel in academically enriched elementary programs and adapt well to the social setting of school. We also have the ability to adapt our program for children with special needs, a practice that sets our school apart and something that we take great pride in. We are non-denominational and fully inclusive. We are thrilled about our potential partnership with the City of Kingston and Rideau Crest Home. We aspire to instill values in our children that we feel correspond well with a multi-generational environment. We teach our children about kindness, empathy, and the importance of giving. And as such, we feel that we could form a relationship with Rideau Crest that would surpass one of just tenancy. We would like to become a part of the Rideau Crest community and have Rideau Crest residents and staff become a part of ours. We feel that bringing older people and growing young children together will enhance the environment for everyone. An intergenerational program that brings older adults and preschool children together would address at least four tenets of the city's strategic plan. These include foster intensification in the city core, revitalize the North End, pursue the implementation of a sustainable plan, and inform future community planning initiatives and services by considering cultural, social, and neighborhood demographics. In addition to addressing the city's strategic plan, an intergenerational program would demonstrate leadership as Kingston strives for an age-friendly city designation through the World Health Organization. Intergenerational programming would benefit both older adults and children of the nursery school. For older adults, the benefits could include physical activity through play-based interactions with the children, an opportunity to transfer knowledge and to be a teacher, the ability to act as a role model to the children, opportunities to just sit and watch the children play and interact, the ability to play games and participate in programs with the children, such as reading together, writing, singing, crafts, indoor and outdoor time, to listen to concerts and performances by the children, and this enhanced socialization can lead to an increased quality of life for the residents. For children, the benefits of intergenerational programming can include the opportunity to interact with seniors at a young age, the ability to learn about the normal aging process, to become accepting of people with disabilities, to learn empathy at a young age, and to learn that some adults need help too. To learn from seniors such as a special skill or knowledge, and to improve reading skills. Some program examples could include outside play, parachute games, crafts, reading programs, creative movement, circle time, community flower gardens, performances, indoor gross motor time, as well as individual talent and skill sharing. There is a wealth of research and many international examples of success stories that demonstrate the value of and benefit of intergenerational programming, the bringing of old and young together. We look forward to being a living example of how history and innovation can thrive in Kingston, and we hope that you will approve the proposed licensing agreement between Allen Detweiler Nursery School at Rita Crest Home. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for the delegation? Okay, seeing none, thank you. We have no briefings tonight. We do have a petition listed in the agenda. A petition bearing approximately 21 signatures was submitted by Councillor Allen on December 19th, 2015, and received in the City Clerk's Department on December 21st, 2015, and reads as follows. We, the residents of Kingston Mills Road from 490 to 513, request the installation of a series of streetlights between the above addresses. This section of Kingston Mills Road is directly east of the Kingston Mills Lock Station. This road is a high traffic area, particularly in the summer. There are primary school age children along this road, as well as numerous pets and wild animals, raccoons, rabbits, turtles, deer, which cross the road. There are frequent cycling groups, as well as local residents who use the roadway to walk or run alongside for exercise. There have been thefts from some of the residents. Most recent 501 Kingston Mills Road and streetlights could be a deterrent to such activity. And that's been referred to the president and CEO of Utilities Kingston. Are there any other petitions to present? Okay, seeing none, we have no motions of congratulations, recognition, sympathy, condolences, and speedy recovery. We do have one deferred motion, that the resignation from Councillor Jim Neal from the Board of Directors for Kingston Access Services be accepted with regret, and that Councillor Blank be appointed to the Board of Directors for Kingston Access Services for a term ending November 30th, 2018. So, 4 weeks later, do we have a volunteer? Anybody? If there's no volunteer, I'm going to ask for a motion to defer, and we'll do this again next meeting. So, going once, going twice. Can I have a motion to defer, please? Moved by Councillor Neal, seconded by Councillor Schell. This is to defer it to our next meeting. Give us another 2 weeks. Please vote. And that carries. Okay, report number 17 from the CAO.
Moved by Councillor McLaren, seconded by Councillor Osanek, that report number 17 from the Chief Administrative Officer consent be received and adopted.
So there are five items in report 17. Would anyone like any of them separated? Councillor Neal, B has been separated. Okay, seeing no other, Councillor Stroud, you wanted to separate item A, is that correct? Because you have a pecuniary interest?
That's correct.
Okay, so what we will do is first we will vote on the ballots. So that would be items C, D, and E. Item C is the Customer Service Center, 362 Montreal Street acquisition of furniture. Item D is the 2016 Municipal Borrowing Bylaw. And item E is the 2016 Interim Tax Levy. So we will call the vote just on those three items. Please vote. And that carries. Next, we will do item A, community license with Alan Detweiler Nursery School at Rideau Crest Home. So Councillor Stroud has stepped away. We will call the vote. And that carries. Item B, City of Kingston, Limestone District School Board, and Kingston-Frontenac Public Library Board Partnership, new secondary school in Kings Court. Councillor Neal.
Yes, thank you very much. I appreciate that at some months ago, both the school board and members of our city staff were able to attend the library board meeting. And we spoke about trying to facilitate a way in order to continue service, library service, in the Kings Court North Williamsville community. And with the plan now for demolition, there may indeed be a couple of years when there isn't either in the new built school nor in the existing King's Court, which is slated for some demolition. But there is a proposal, and I think a very sensible proposal within this report that suggests that a kiosk could be made available so that library service could continue, even if the library doesn't exist in its current location in King's Court. And I'd just like to ask our staff if it might be feasible to facilitate in Q2 or Q3 of 2016, after the demolition of the existing King's Court takes place, if it might be possible to facilitate the capital purchase of the kiosk and possibly to locate it in the best appropriate site, which may well be the Memorial Center. Perhaps staff could address that.
Commissioner Hurdle.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. So I think I have some good news for council based on some more recent conversations that we've had with the school board. We've been able to look at a demolition of the King's Court Library branch that would be around the spring, summer of 2017. So that provides an extended period of time in terms of local services for the library branch in King's Court. So in terms of the kiosk itself, the kiosk can be budgeted for in 2017, recognizing obviously that the branch will be open longer, and it could be purchased ahead of time and located somewhere else if that's where council and the library board would like to go in the interim basis. But ultimately, the purpose of the kiosk is to provide a permanent service in the new secondary school that will be accessible to the public. So we know that there would be obviously a break in service, but recognizing that the demolition is going to be pushed to a later date in 2017, that break in service will not be as significant as initially anticipated.
I appreciate that information, and if there's a way that we can facilitate through a kiosk, a non-interruption in library service for King's Court, Northern Williamsville community, that would be great. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Holland.
Thank you, Your Worship. So
I had the opportunity to speak about this report, speak with members of the Kings Court Community Association last week, and members of the community have known that this transition is going to take place for some time now, would like to bring to the forefront some points, including the fact that the Kings Court Library branch, the actual use of the facility has not diminished over time. It has maintained, it has been fairly stable and increased. That this transition has to do with the fact that there was a consultant's report that recommended that the branch go to Rideau Heights. So it's important to members of the Kings Court community that that point be made, because they valued that library. The library was well used. The hours of service were minimal compared to other branches in the city, but that was the case based on the fact that the branch was always relatively small. One of their concerns, apart from the disruption in service, had to do with the use of the community room. The partnership that's proposed in this report is excellent, I would say, and I think members of the community feel the same way, that they are very happy to see that what's coming together here is what we've talked about in this council, it as resembling something that looks like a community hub. However, some of the nuances of that relationship are not quite worked out yet. So the fact that there is space allocated and that it will be used in the same way that the QE school has been used as a resource to the community is a very popular idea, although there's some concern over who owns the space, who's monitoring the use of the space, who's dealing with the sign up and the use of the space, and who's providing programming in the space. I know we haven't gotten to that point yet, but I think it's just important to bring up the fact that what everybody in the area would like to see is that it is actually truly a community space, that it is not a school board space that is, you know, primarily used for the school board, or that it then that library service continues in the form of programming in that space. So I've had the opportunity to discuss this with staff and am quite confident that all of those considerations are being dealt with at this point, but anything further would be that staff would have to comment on that would be welcome.
Commissioner Hurdle.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. So yes, we've had a number of conversations with the school board, and obviously not all the details have yet been worked out. We wanted to make sure that council was supportive of this partnership before we went any further. But the intent is to have the space booked by the school board, because they do own the space. Having said that, community usage will be the priority, and that's something that we've been able to set with the school board. So we know that currently there are a number of community uses happening at QECVI that will be displaced with the demolition of the school. So we're looking at how can those community usage be accommodated in the community room. And above and beyond that, we know that the library board has an interest in continuing to provide library programs and would make use of that community room. There are other organizations that we anticipate will also want to make use of the room, but we haven't gone out as far as approach those organizations yet. We didn't want to do that until we had a sense of where council wanted to go with this partnership.
Okay, so we will call the vote. And that carries. Report number 18 from the CAO.
Moved by Councillor George, second by Councillor Neal, that report number 18 from the Chief Administrative Officer recommend be received and adopted.
So there is just the one clause. It is the preliminary design for the third crossing of the Cataract Way River award of contract. So anyone that wishes to speak to this? Councillor Neal.
I'm not going to kind of reiterate everything that was said at the last meeting, but I still have serious reservations that we're going with the highest bidder on our RFP process, and that that another very reputable contractor who has won awards for bridge design as close as Ottawa came in $1 million less and yet we're being asked to support this particular project. And for that reason, I again will be unable to vote for this as it now appears. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Candon.
Thank you, and through you. I guess I just want to clarify why I had originally voted to defer the original recommendation, and that is because the $1 million seemed like it really jumped out at me, and I felt like I wasn't necessarily as concerned as much that staff had made the wrong choice, but I just didn't have enough information to be comfortable making to make a choice at that moment. I mean, in my regular life, I've had moments as a general contractor where somebody says, trust me, I've got this. And there's been many instances where that has come back to bite me. And I didn't want to do that, given the fact that this is the biggest, the biggest investment in infrastructure in the history of Eastern Ontario, I think. And I felt that the report was very vague, and it made me a bit uneasy. And it doesn't mean necessarily that I thought staff had made the wrong choice. I just knew that down the road, as we go through this, we need to have benchmarks as to why we're making the decisions that we're making. And I feel that the information report was quite strong in conveying a few messages, and the meeting that that we did have with staff, I felt was quite productive. I found out in that meeting that we weren't just voting for J.L. Richards, we were voting for a team approach. So when I had originally looked up who was doing the engineering design, I didn't see a lot of background information necessarily on J.L. Richards, and found out that it was Parsons, which is actually who we're voting for if we do vote in favor of this recommendation. And that Golders, which is another company, I believe, that did the geotechnical components of the bridge, were significantly seemed to be more advanced, which would decrease the likelihood of us having cost overages over the long haul. So we were investing in something that seemed like it was much more advanced, which I didn't realize that when we were asked to vote the first time, at least not in the same amount of detail that I now know. I feel like, based on the discussions that we've had, if we do vote for this recommendation, we're going to be voting for less surprises and less time delays, even though we are, a decreased likelihood in a time delay. So whenever you are doing any type of general contracting, you hear the word surprise or delay, that comes at a huge dollar value usually. So even though we are, I'm going to recommend that we do support this, because we, to the best of my knowledge and belief, and based on this information report, I think we're voting for less surprises, less delays, and less maintenance on the bridge over the long haul. But at the same time, we're also investing in a bridge that's a high quality bridge. So we're not investing in a bridge that's going to be only good for a few years. Again, it's further advanced, which leads me to believe that it's better value for money long term. And I just think that the reason this happened was that I think that staff made the right choice, but they didn't give council the reasons to support that right choice. And now that I think we have it, I'm happy to support this recommendation. And I think that in the future, we need to not just have the right choice, but also the reasons to back it up. Otherwise, we may see more deferrals of this kind. And I think that it seems like in politics, no matter what you do, you'll have your critics. But now that we have this document, I think that we will be able to have a better dialogue with the community. If anybody's critical of us, you can say, have you read the information report? If the answer is no, we should say, please read that report, and we'll discuss the details and the theories behind that, and then have it based on this. Because I feel like when we don't have an information report like we do now, it allows for things like conspiracy theories to start, and people start, the dialogue just kind of wanders off into a lot of different hypotheticals and things of that nature.
30 seconds.
And now that we do have this, I am more confident to vote for the recommendation.
Thank you. Is there anybody else that wishes to speak? Councillor McLaren.
Thank you. So I did talk with staff about this, and I was given some pretty good answers, but I didn't find them entirely satisfactory. So I'm just going to repeat some of the questions that I had asked and my understanding of some of the answers and why I felt that they were maybe not quite ideal. So the first issue that I had was with regards to the actual value as to whether this is the best value for the city. And when I did the calculations by taking, for example, the cost per point, if you divide the total price by the amount of the technical score that was given to it by staff, J.L. Richards does not come in first. It's actually MMM Group. They seem to be based on a cost per value calculation, the best option here. And I understand that there is at least several ways of calculating value, and that the one that is calculated in this report is one way. But when we did this a little while ago with Corcoran and Taggart, if we do it the cost per point value, then the correct answer would be to do it with Corcoran. If we're to be consistent, it would not be J.L. Richards this time. A second point was in the secondary report, a great many of the reasons why we are not taking, or why the other five or the other four companies did not rank well enough, seemed to be something that they could learn or do or actually provide with very little cost. So for example, at one point it was mentioned that J.L. Richards was chosen because they actually named the names of the people who would be working on each of their roles. I don't think things like that are worth an extra $1 million. So that I found problematic. And the third thing was that J.L. Richards is going to be doing an extra bit of work front-ended. They're going to be digging a few more boreholes, and this is going to be quite expensive, apparently close to $1 million. According to the report, it seems that we could do this later. If we were to actually do this later, it may actually cost us less. And part of the reason is that right now we're paying the full price. But when we get federal and provincial funding, the cost would be split three ways. So it seems that we shouldn't be spending as much money as we can now. We should actually be spending as little as we can now so that it can be split better in the future. And that was part of the main problematic aspect of this. So I do find it difficult to support this, but not being an engineer, I do not know what the best solution would be. At this point, these are the concerns that I have. Actually, there is one more. This has to do with, I guess, the risk analysis. If we were to take the cheapest one and the most expensive one by my calculation is about 79% more expensive. If there is a cost overrun from the cheapest one, they would have to be a cost overrun of greater than 79% before it even equals the most expensive one. And although we don't have a full comprehensive risk analysis, and that would be, I understand, way too expensive to do and too much time consuming, it does seem that we should at least be prudent at the beginning and defer these extra costs until later. These are just some of the main concerns that I have, and this is a tough decision for me. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Hutchison.
Thank you, Your Worship. I think it would, the issues have been raised about this, of course, have been well discussed. I think it would be remiss of me not to say that as this project proceeds, I get an increasing number of calls or emails, mostly calls actually, even from the east side about the overall cost of the project as projected. And I have consistently, after supporting the EA way back when, 10 years ago, I have consistently, I think pretty consistently, argued that the bridge is premature in its scheduling. And that's because I think that we need to demonstrate as a city that this bridge will not be a span to sprawl, as some people have called it, and that we do not have the policies, effective policies in place to prevent further urban sprawl, which leads to higher costs for the city and higher taxes for the population, both because capital costs are never paid for in urban sprawl, low density urban sprawl, and because operating costs are never paid for because there's simply not enough taxpayers per kilometer in a low density situation. So, and then I get people telling me that they're concerned about if we're building this, then we have the environmental issues.
So Councillor Hutchison, I'm gonna stop you there. I actually said this at the last meeting. This is not a debate on the third crossing. This is a debate on a recommendation from staff referring to an award of contract for something that council has already given approval for. So the debate tonight needs to be centered on whether we want to go with the staff recommendation for that or not. So I am going to ask you please focus your comments on that, and just to the rest of council as well. I have absolutely no doubt that there will be the opportunity to have that debate on whether or not we do in fact want to go ahead with the final building of the third crossing, but that's just not the focus right here tonight. Thank you.
I appreciate that. I just would say that numbers of people in the public don't see it that way. They see it as death by a thousand smaller cuts. So that's why I brought it up, because that's the nature of the objections I'm getting from different people from different parts of the city. So I won't go on in respect to ruling, but I felt I had to give it a shot.
Noted.
Thank you. I won't vote for this for the reasons I gave.
Thank you. Councillor Straub.
Thank you, Your Worship. And thank you to my colleagues for through deferral, encouraging a healthy debate on this subject. As my colleague, Councillor Candon, said on another issue, no one's ever been hurt by doing too much homework. So that's, and I agree with everything that he said regarding asking for more information and a more detailed report, which we have received, and so thank you to staff for that. Also, I was at the meeting that he referred to where staff went through the details of the report, and I think that to sum it up, you could say that they made a very good case for the engineering side and the technical side, that JL Richards does have the best proposal technically, and that is reflected in the scores. And of course, also in the scores is that one column for financial, and that is where I'm going to focus my comments. So all previous councillors, Councillor Candon, Councillor Hutchison, Councillor McLaren, all mentioned cost as a concern. This is because this is what we're hearing in the community. This is the primary topic for discussion of all the communication I've received on this subject, and I've received I've received input from folks in different districts, not just my own, including the district that would be served most by the bridge in the east. So the cost is primary concern. So to focus on that part of the report, you'll notice the financial scores ranged from 14.4 for JL Richards for the highest cost to 25.0 or 25 out of 25 for MMM Group for the lowest bid. So you'll see there's a difference of 10.6 points between the highest and the lowest bid. And I asked this question in the meeting that we had that the CAO and three members of senior staff were so kind to have with us before the holidays. So I'll ask it again now. Because I've been told the answer is that you the proportion of points that you lose starts with the value of full points for the lowest bid, and then the ratio of the cost ratio above that. So in other words, if it was twice as expensive, you would get half the points. And you see that with JL Richards, they get slightly more than 12.5 points. They got 14.4 for a bid that was almost twice as much. So that's where the math is coming from. And I would just like to ask staff why we do it that way, because what I'm hearing in the community is that the highest bid should get 0 points and it should go up from there in the reverse ratio. And why do we do it in this fashion?
Mr. Van Buren.
Through your worship, the methodology for awarding points for the financial component of the RFP was actually described by way of a formula that was included in the RFP document. So all of the proponents that submitted proposals were fully aware in terms of how the actual financial score was going to be calculated. I think city staff, in terms of looking at RFPs for a range of different projects, have determined that that is an appropriate way of developing a financial score that, again, would be based on the notion, as you had mentioned earlier, that we would be awarding full points for the lowest bid, and then looking at a reduction in points based on other proponents that are submitting higher scores. There may be a number of different ways to develop the scoring for the financial component, but that was certainly an agreed upon approach to take for this particular RFP. And again, that information was made available to all the proponents from the outset of the procurement.
Thank you. And I did understand that in the briefing that we had, and so I'm passing forward that concern I'm hearing from the public. Because theoretically, if it had been calculated in a different way, with JL Richards losing all the points for financial for having the highest bid, then truly 25 points would have been at stake. And MMM wouldn't have gotten the full 25, but they would have gotten a bigger margin, making it easier for them to overtake the highest technical score with the 25%, in my personal opinion, a better reflection of having 25% as the true weighting. If you look at this in this setting, the likelihood of getting a bid that is three or four times higher than another bid is very low, and even if you did, you would still only lose a third. You would get a third of the points or a quarter of the points, so you'd still get a significant number of points under this system. So you can see that it was very difficult for the lower bids to actually overtake the highest technical bidder, and therefore making the column for financial almost moot. However, we were still faced with the reality that the highest technical proposal, the best technical proposal, is coming from JL Richards. So then we're back to the value for money arguments that Council McLaren was mentioning. And so how do we do that? Because the question is, are we asking for the Cadillac of preliminary designs, or are we asking for a more modest preliminary design that will still get the job done? So maybe if staff could just one more time explain how the cost overruns will be minimized, the risk of cost overruns will be minimized, because as we know, bridge projects sometimes go double the budget of the original estimate. So how can how are the cost overruns minimized with going with the highest bid at the beginning?
Mr. Van Buren.
Through your worship, in response to that question, again, the management of costs and mitigating cost overruns, again, would be a primary consideration that we would take on a project of this nature. And part and parcel of that is going to be through effective project management through the course of the preliminary design. That being said, as the review team was looking at all of the proposals that were being submitted, one of the things that we're looking at quite critically is to make sure that there is going to be a sufficient allocation of resources to make sure that the work can be completed. And as we tried to indicate in the supplemental information that we provided, is that some of the other consultants in their proposals, there was a concern that there may not be an appropriate amount of resources, or maybe even more importantly, a sufficient allocation of those resources amongst all of the different tasks that were involved in the preliminary design, that then would elevate the level of risk that some of the other consultants actually may be seeking scope increases and the associated increase in budget that would have to go along with those scope increases.
So, Councillor Stroud, just a note, you have 30 seconds on the clock.
Thank you. So I'll just wrap up by saying that the decision in my mind for us here tonight is whether or not we achieve the purpose of the preliminary design by supporting staff's recommendation with the highest bidder, and is that our only option, or can we achieve the same goals and save money at the same time with a different option, because clearly there is more than one qualified bidder here on the table. So that is the decision, and I'm going to think about it before the vote. I have not decided at this point. Thank you.
Thank you. Deputy Mayor Bohm, will you take the chair?
Yes, Your Worship, and I recognize you.
Thank you. I think it's been noted by a couple of speakers that this is a difficult decision. It is an important decision. I think it's important to clarify exactly where we are at, because we have already granted approval to go ahead with a preliminary design for the third crossing. So if this is voted down, then staff are going to have to go through the whole RFP process all over again and report back to us with a number of menu options. In my view, the critical question is, are we looking at value for money? And it's a trade-off. If everyone was offering the same amount of service and one is charging a higher price, it makes perfect sense to say no. But it's important to recognize that the highest price option is coming with a superior level of service. And in my view, the trade-off is between saving money now and paying for it later, or paying a little bit more now and saving larger dollars down the road. In my view, I am convinced that the JLR Richards option is the best. We are talking about a very complex project, stakeholder engagement with Parks Canada, with the Aboriginal community. This is not just about building a bridge. This is a very, very complex project. So we need the best menu of services to make sure that this gets done right. And for those of you that have been on council before, you know what it's like when staff have to come back to us and ask for more money on a project we've already approved. That is no fun at all. And the way that this I read this is that the JL Richards contract can only go down in price, and the others can only go up in price. So I think we need to think about that risk moving forward. That being said, I want to commend Councillor Candon for asking the questions at the last meeting and for moving this deferral, because it's very clear that our job is to
point of order. Yeah, deferral was actually moved by me and seconded by Councillor Candon.
Okay. Noted.
I stand corrected. My apologies. I want to thank Councillor Candon and Councillor Stroud for together putting forward this deferral, because we do have a lot more information. Because it is important to the community that we are demonstrating that we are doing our due diligence, that we are clearly evaluating, is this extra $1 million worth it? In my view, it is. So I would encourage council to vote for this. Let's move forward with the preliminary design for the third crossing. Thank you.
And I return the chair.
Thank you. Next on my list is Councillor Allen.
Thank you. And as Councillor Bohm often says, you've said much of what I was planning to say. But I do have a couple questions that I'd like to ask of staff. And that is, there's two things that are of interest to me here is Councillor McLaren referred to the geotechnical information being deferred to a later phase. What are the benefits of doing that geotechnical work in this design phase for us? Why should we support doing more work at this stage of the game rather than waiting to see if we have other players at the table and integrating it into the build side of the phase?
Mr. Van Buren.
Through Your Worship, the collection of the geotechnical information and the more of that information that we can collect sooner as opposed to later will offer more certainty as it relates to the preliminary design and also the associated cost estimates. I think the other thing that I'd like to mention as well to council is that this is information that's going to have to be collected at some point or time or other in the project. So we either collect that information now and we derive the benefit of having that information and allowing that to provide more certainty around the project, the design and the cost estimates, or we collect it at a later point in time. I think the other thing that I'd like to make mention of is that the cost to collect the geotechnical information relies to a large extent on the mobilization effort to actually collect that information. So in this case, it's actually mobilizing barges that will actually have to float out into the Cataraqui River with the appropriate equipment that then is going to be able to actually to bore or drill those holes to collect the information. So there's certainly an economy of scale to collect that information or more of that information now, which eliminates the subsequent mobilization fees at some point later on in the future. The other and last issue that I'd like to raise is that, again, more certainty that we bring to the design and the preliminary design at this point in time reduces the probability that as we collect information at a later point in time in the future, that additional information that comes to us in the future actually may necessitate some design alterations. And I think council needs to be aware that if we have to get in design alterations, that will have a cost. So again, more of the information that we have now actually probably works more in our favor by reducing the overall costs over a longer and extended period of time.
Thank you. In your report, thank you for the additional information. I appreciate it, and appreciate your willingness to go through some of the questions I had before this. You had mentioned that JL Richards had a superior consultation plan to the other consultants. Can you just help clarify for council here a few of the aspects of that consultation and why it's superior? As we know, over the past year, consultation is very important to this community, and we want to make sure it's done right.
Through your worship. Yes, again, the review team that was looking at all of the submissions felt, again, that the JL Richards team had had the superior public consultation plan, and also the stakeholder, the level of effort that was involved in terms of meeting with the project stakeholders, and again, stressing the importance that the work through this preliminary design phase is going to be important to build that consensus with some of the principal stakeholders in the project. The supplementary report makes special mention of Parks Canada, again, because they are the stewards of that particular section of the Cataraqui River, and satisfying their requirements is going to be critically important in terms of the overall success of moving this project forward. So what JL Richards had provided in their submission was an extensive level of actual meetings that would occur with all of the principal stakeholders. In fact, I think there was a dozen of these meetings that were going to be planned throughout the course of the preliminary design effort that would capture all of the principal stakeholders to make sure that they are in the same room together to be talking about all of the pertinent information related to the project. We did not see that level of effort in terms of engagement with the principal stakeholders in the other consultant submissions.
Thank you, I appreciate that. And I appreciate your comments about risk. I think it's important that we have as much information as possible up front through this design stage in order to make the best decisions about whether the bridge goes forward, what the bridge looks like, how we build that bridge, everything that comes forward. The more holes we leave by taking a smaller package that will inform us somewhat, will leave us with room to not be sure about things and worry a bit about how we're going to move forward. I think that when we're looking at a project of this scale where we're not looking to spend $2.5 million of taxpayer dollars, but eventually $120 or $150 million, we want to make sure we have enough information so that we can mitigate any risks that are coming forward throughout the complexity of this project. And I've spent a lot of time talking to people who have managed large projects, and time again, the more effort put in up front saves money in the long run for various reasons. Better planning, better preparation, and just more information to be able to make decisions rather than saying, oh, we need to go get that information, delaying things. So I like this, and I also like, as the mayor indicated, that the price for this could only go down. The J.L. Richards contract, should we vote for it, is an upset limit where the others have additional services that they can add to their packages for a cost. And so we're looking at a potential savings. All of the proposals are under budget, but this is the best value for us to move forward on. And so I'm going to support this because I want to be able to make the best decisions I can in the future when it comes to this bridge. And that means having enough information and having all the stakeholders participating fully in this. So thank you.
Thank you. Councillor George.
Thank you, Your Worship. I think what yourself and Councillor Allen and a few others have said were very well put. I think you go back to the old Mr. Transmission ads, most of you will remember from years ago, you know, you pay me now or pay me later. And I know myself, having been asked through my company to do work on behalf of companies that have been awarded contracts, you don't always get your best value for the one that's been awarded the contract at the lowest cost. I see that, and many other the other tradespeople see the same thing. And so it's a risk that you run. But the one thing that I do want to say to staff, when I thank Mr. Van Buren, Mr. Franco, and I believe Mr. McLeod, who authored this, in all the years that I've involved on council and asking for a summary and a breakdown, I think this one is one of the most, if not the most informative package I've received. And having a look through this and taking some of the argument we've already heard this evening in regards to the point scoring, if you take that out of the evaluation and simply look at what you're getting for your dollar value, I totally agree with what staff has presented to us as far as their understanding. And mind you, we did not see all the RFPs, so we have to rely on our team of staff members who went through this, and I'm sure we're very critical of it. But, you know, at the end of the day, I mean, there's certain issues that I highlighted that I think certainly lend support to this particular project going to J.L. Richards. When you look at some of the criteria that Parks Canada has, and the fact that the Parsons is going to be involved with J.L. Richard, and Parks Canada specifically wants to see some comparators to the Vimy Memorial Bridge, which in fact they were involved in. The others didn't offer this type of thing. That's just one example. And I think one of the ones too that hasn't been pointed out, I think Councillor Allen was just kind of alluding to it, and that is the fact that J.L. Richards is the only one who's indicated that if they find efficiencies, then obviously we're not going to be charged out as much. So they've put that rate in there, and I think that that's something that is a real plus for them. We're looking a little higher cost, as Councillor Allen has pointed out, it still fits in with the budget that we've already approved for this project. I think that one of the things we have to do is we have to make sure that we get a good quality product. And with this particular RFP awarding of this contract, I believe we will. Councillor McLaren spoke briefly to the ability to access one-third funding down the road. Well, we've all heard from day one that if we don't have all of our T's crossed and I's dotted and we're not shovel ready, we're not going to be in a position to put our application forward to obtain any of that funding. When that funding does come, if it comes, and we have been told by our local representatives they're going to fight on our behalf. We have to be ready, because if we're not, there are going to be a lot of other municipalities standing in line well ahead of us, and we're going to miss out again. So we don't want to be in that position, and this allows us to take that next step forward. And the other thing I think I'll just touch on just briefly, Your Worship, is the fact that it's, in my opinion only, I believe it's a little too late to start turning the clock back. We have spent millions of dollars on this project recently. When you take into account the EA process, when you take into account land purchases, various studies that have been done over the many years to get us to the point in time where we are, I'd hate to see that taxpayer, those taxpayers' dollars having gone to waste. And that's one of my fears, that if we decide to drop the ball now, that's going to be a loss to our community, and it's something we've invested in with the hopes they're supportive of what we are doing on their behalf.
30 seconds.
And I think the only other thing I'd add is I've heard from maybe a dozen individuals in opposition to this project, so I'm very curious to know what the other 123,988 individuals, according to our latest sign, think about this. And if they let us know, we'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Bohm.
Thank you, Your Worship, and through you. I think we've heard a lot of good and healthy debate and information tonight, and just I'd like to start off with a quick question for staff and rely on their expertise here. So would it be fair to basically say that having more info up front on a project of this magnitude would likely actually increase our chances of being able to access government funding from different levels?
Mr. Van Buren.
Through Your Worship, I would reiterate that having more information will provide an elevated level of certainty. And again, I think what we would like to do at a staff level is to make sure that when we bring back future information to this council, that you have the best information to make the best choices as it relates to any of the next steps associated with the project. And part of that is obviously going to be driven on making sure that you get very good updated cost estimates. Those cost estimates, in theory, are going to be the information that we'll then put forward to upper levels of government as the measure for actually looking at grant funding opportunities. So again, more certainty, which is going to show itself in terms of the more certainty related to the cost estimates.
Thank you. So essentially what we've heard there is that when we're going for other levels of funding, we're going to be going within Ontario against hundreds of other municipalities to try to access funding. We're going to be going across Canada against thousands of other municipalities to try to access funding. So I think it's fair to say that the people who have done their homework and who are ready and have the best information going forward to access that funding are likely going to be the ones that are successful accessing that funding. So this comes down to, and I've got a bunch of notes and I'm going to go through them, and a lot of this has already been heard, but getting the people who have the best experience, the best demonstrated ability, stakeholder consultation, understanding the scope of the project. The recommended one before us is going to do more boreholes, which is going to give us more information up front and allow us to make better decisions and have a better preliminary design. They're going to put more resources on the project, and they showed a greater understanding of the project overall. Recently, I'm sure everybody saw in the news, there was a bridge that I believe was approximately $106 million to build, and I think it just opened last November, and I believe it links Eastern Canada with Western Canada. I believe it's in Nipigon and it crosses that river. I also believe that right now one portion of it is sitting 2 feet higher than the other portion and it's closed. And the city has now opened their community centers to deal with this. And essentially the only overland route in that area now is to go through the states. So it went to the lowest bidder. It was a tendered contract. So sometimes saving, or what seems like saving $1 million up front can cost you millions or tens of millions or hundreds of millions of dollars over the life of the project, or it can have an embarrassment like this happen. So essentially,
something like this, we're getting the best information up front, it's likely to reduce the cost over the life of the project, simply because we're building it with the best information possible. And again, you know, we're not engineers, so we're relying on our hired experts to provide us with that best information. So we're going to get better value by getting more information in the initial planning design stages, which is likely to help us realize future cost efficiencies. So I believe it was Councillor Allen that mentioned it may be $1 million more now, but this is not a $1 million decision. This is $120 million decision. And having those facts up front is allowing us to make the best decision going forward. So it's our goal as a council, I believe, and everybody around this table, I'm sure, would share this, to get the best value for the tax dollar. And that does not necessarily mean the lowest bidder. And we've got a perfect example of that. And it couldn't have happened, you know, at a more opportune time for this debate with the Nipigon River Bridge. So we've now got two reports indicating all the reasons why this is the best proposal before us. And I also, as far as we're talking about the community and respecting their wishes with the value of the RFP, is there was a recent poll in the Whig Standard, I believe, that had a roughly 1,000 people answer, and over 80% were in favor of an additional crossing. So if we're respecting the tax dollars, we're also doing the best value at the same time respecting the will of the majority. So it's not just a city bridge. People live, work, and play everywhere. And essentially, this RFP will provide the best value for our tax dollars going forward. And again, that's not necessarily the lowest bidder. And we've got a perfect example of why the lowest bidder may not be the best value. So obviously, I'm going to be supporting this, and I would encourage everybody else to support this recommendation. And I would like to thank staff again for the two reports on this project, providing a wealth of information showing that the homework was done and this is truly the best decision going forward. Thank you.
Thank you. So we will call the vote. Please vote. And that carries by a vote of 7-5. Okay, report number 19 from the Administrative Policies Committee.
My apologies. So,
yes. Councillor Bowman was still looking at the vote on the third crossing. Okay.
That's right. Okay, so I have before me the report from the Administrative Policies Committee, duly moved and seconded. Thank you.
Moved by Councillor Boehm, second by Councillor Holland. That report number 19 from the Administrative Policies Committee be received and adopted.
So there are three clauses. Would anyone like any of them separated? Seeing none, number one is amendment to natural areas and parkland acquisition policy. Number two is the council support internship position, and number three is the amendment to the procedural bylaw appeal of ruling of the chair. We will call the vote. And that carries. Report number 20 from the Arts, Recreation, and Community Policies Committee.
This is my pleasure as chair of the Arts, Recreation, Community Policies Committee to present report number 20 for consideration by council.
Moved by Councillor Hutchison, second by Councillor Boehm, that report number 20 from the Ministry of Policy, the Arts, Recreation, Community Policies Committee be received and adopted.
So there is just the one clause, West Branch Little Kakarequay Creek Trail Feasibility Study. Call the vote. And that carries. Report number 21 from the Environment, Infrastructure, and Transportation Policies Committee.
Thank you, Your Worship. I rise now to present report number 21, duly moved and seconded, and ask that Council receive and adopt it.
Moved by Councillor Stroud, second by Councillor Allen, that report number 21 from the Environment, Infrastructure, and Transportation Policies Committee be received and adopted.
So there are three items. Would anyone like any separations? Seeing none, we will vote on them as a whole. Number one is the metal appliance and fixture collection. Number two is the Kingston Environmental Advisory Forum work planning recommendations. And number three is blue-green algae. We'll call the vote. And that carries. Nothing from Committee of the Whole tonight. We do have a number of information reports, so I'll just read them, and if you have any questions, just raise your hand. So number one is the preliminary design for the third crossing of the Cataraqui River Award of Contracts, supplemental information. I think we've covered that one. Number two, Kingston, Frontenac, Lennox, and Addington Community Risk Watch Program. Number three, report on Delegated Authority Bylaw 2014-141 for real estate transactions completed from July 2015 to December 2015. Number four, 2015 Priority Status Matrix Year-End Status Update. Okay, we have no information reports from members of council. Miscellaneous business, that the resignation of Dr. Christo Avalis from the Housing and Homelessness Advisory Committee be received with regret. Can I have a mover, please? Moved by Councillor Neal, seconded by Councillor Shell. Please vote. And that carries. We have no new motions. Are there any notices of motion? Mr. Clerk, I'll ask for minutes.
Moved by Councillor McLaren, second by Councillor Stroud, that the minutes of City Council meeting number 2016-02 held Tuesday, December 15th, 2015 be confirmed.
Please vote. And that carries. A number of tabling of documents, a number of communications. Is there any other business? Mr. Clerk, I'll ask for bylaws.
Mr. Mayor, we'll begin with bylaw number five.
Okay, so Councillor Hutchison has stepped away.
So it's moved by Councillor Holland, seconded by Councillor Boehm, that bylaw five be given first and second reading.
Please vote. And that carries.
Moved by Councillor Holland, second by Councillor Boehm, that bylaws 1-4 and bylaws 6-9, as well as bylaw 16, be given first and second reading.
Please vote. And that carries.
Moved by Councillor Holland, second by Councillor Boehm, that clause 11.34 of bylaw number 2010-1 be suspended for the purpose of giving bylaws 1 and 2 three readings.
Please vote. And that carries.
Moved by Councillor Holland, second by Councillor Boehm, that bylaws 1, 2, and 10 through 16 be given their third reading.
Please vote. And that carries. Motion to adjourn, please. Moved by Deputy Mayor Boehm, seconded by Councillor Neal. Please vote. And that carries. Thank you very much.